Hi, guys. I do have the pleasure of being your last speaker, so I promise I will not come in between all of the celebrations that await. I promise to keep this topical and tasty. So, topical, how many of you guys love tennis? Hands in the room? All right, well, that'll do. And how many of you guys like tacos or Mexican nights? Oh, brilliant. So we're off to a great start. So I'm Arjoon. I am currently the international head of ideas, growth ideas and creative for General Mills. And General Mills is one of the biggest food companies in the world. We have some well-loved... That's not working? That's probably better, right? And I'm amped up. That's a lot of work. So General Mills has much-loved brands like Häagen-Dazs, Old El Paso, Nature Valley, Betty Crocker, and I have the fun job of being able to create incredible growth ideas, taking our brands into culture, and amplifying the experiences with our incredible marketing teams. So I'm here to talk to you guys about Old El Paso, an example where we were able to actually leverage everything, tennis and tacos, but also purpose, commerce, and experience all in one, and with a large sprinkling of influencers, which I know really, really matters. So, how do I click though? Okay, so green to move. Should I just stay here? That's probably better. Right. I'm glad to know that most of you like Mexican and you're probably familiar with Old El Paso, and clearly the formatting's gone for a bit of a toss, down to the fact that we have a very bespoke font. But at Old El Paso, we talk about good noise. So we're on a mission. So Old El Paso, when you see an Old El Paso ad, you'll always see make some noise. Where we talk about being able to provoke and inspire the good noise that happens when people truly connect. So noise is a function of our food that's vibrant, and the people, which is all about sharing, and that sort of connects up to creating good noise. But as a brand that was founded in El Paso, at the border of Texas and Mexico, and a brand that really had generosity and giving at the heart of its DNA, we've always been about being able to help the homeless, or the roofless, if you will, because we've always had a roof over our head, so we always helped those who didn't. And so for us, the noise that we make obviously is not only about what we say, but really acting as a force for good in bringing good noise in the world. So there was an interesting challenge that we were posed with. And in a little bit of a background, you know, as we were working on one of our biggest ever innovations, we were fraught with a little problem, as in, you know, we are loved, but oh my God, Mexican night is messy, right? Folding is a challenge, kids struggle, parents have to get involved, and it breaks. So it gave birth to our biggest ever innovation, which was the tortilla pocket, right? The first ever no spills, no mess tortilla. It had a bottom. It was our biggest innovation in 7 years. And we had to do something dramatically different to how we've ever communicated before. So how did we take forward this game-changing innovation and turn this into something remarkable? Here's how. So obviously, a great product idea. But when it came to comms, we needed an idea that was as remarkable as our product. So our challenge and our brief to our agency was to be able to create a spark in culture and really get consumers immersed over and above everything that we were going to be doing and above the line or below the line. And so we came up with the idea of mess-free, right? If it is really mess-free, can it really stand up to the test with world-class athletes? Could they really play their sport full tilt without spilling any of their Mexican tortillas? How did we do? Well, to start with, creating good noise needed to take a bit of a punt. So while we're in the topic of tennis, we needed someone who would really drive headlines. Someone who went from being bad boy to being good boy. Highly debatable, but someone who was sure to hit headlines. Someone who was really becoming a force for good. as we think to 2020 and the pandemic, Nick Kyrgios, one of the biggest headliners in tennis, one of the biggest talents out of Australia, opted out of playing as the tour returned, and he focused on a lot of philanthropy work in his native Canberra with his NK Foundation. He definitely had our attention, and to get him on board, the first time we said, hey, we're going to have Nick Kyrgios create something called a mess-free challenge and play tennis, hit tweeners through his legs. Everyone was like, Nick Kyrgios for a much-loved family brand. Are you effing serious? But we, you know, it was a bold punt, and we felt like we're going to have to go with this. So while we had legal and everyone up to their ears, we launched it with Nick. Nick played full-scale tennis, dropped it on his social media, and the news headlines went berserk all over Australia. And everybody wanted in. Everybody wanted to be part of Nick's mess-free challenge. Athletes, consumers, everywhere. And, you know, the results we had were pretty stonking. And it even had us by surprise, because we hadn't quite imagined the response that we were going to have when Nick Kyrgios played tennis and dropped it on social. And suddenly all of Australia was buzzing and talking about it. We realized that this was an incredible opportunity, but it really had to align with a moment in culture. We worked with Nick to decide that, hey, while the US Open was finishing, which was the first Grand Slam, which was in sort of September, as tennis was returning, as live sport was returning in the first wave of COVID, that's kind of when Nick launched the challenge. But we also knew that in literally 2 to 3 weeks from then, we were going to have the French Open for the first time happening in late fall, where all of the world's tennis players were assembling. And this was a huge opportunity for us to take this global and turn it into a real movement. And so we did. We really did turn it into a global movement whereby you had players from all around the world. I'm not going to ask you who they are. I'm not going to ask you to take a guess. But literally, in every continent, players wanted in, and they wanted in, and you'll see how and why they wanted in. So when we launched with Nick, the idea was everyone that shared his post allowed us to create donations to food banks in Australia. Australia had gone through a really, really hard time. Food insecurity was at its peak. Nick Kyrgios' foundation with Food Bank Australia started with a donation of 10,000 meal kits. Mexican meal kits, and the world wanted in during the French Open. I'm gonna go back. I'm gonna play it. Does this video play? That's a video. No?
Hey guys, I'm going to give the old El Paso mess-free challenge a crack. Tortilla pocket in one hand while I do my thing, no problem.
Yeah, baby, that's better than you, Nick.
Nick Kyrgios, the bad boy of tennis, is the leading star in an online advertising campaign.
You teamed up with Old El Paso. I love this stuff so much.
Come take a global, Andy Murray. I challenge you. I want to see it. No chance it's going to be better.
Thanks a lot for your nomination. Your one looked a little bit easy, though, so I'm going to try something a little bit harder.
Ja. Das heißt, links musst du Tortilla.
Fireball.
These are low looks.
Let's see what you got.
Paso, we're truly being a force for good.
Boom.
The WTA and the ATP told us this was the biggest constellation of tennis stars ever involved in a single brand campaign. All of this literally happened over 3 weeks organically, with them getting involved, with all of them really bought into the mission of being able to raise 100,000 meal kit donations on the back of Nick's 10,000. You know, the players loved it. Gamesmanship was at its best. So when Nick challenged Andy Murray to take it global during the French Open, he said, you know what, I don't hit tweeners like you, but I got skills in keepy-uppies, so here we go. And that's how it really, really spread, and that's where the headlines happened all around the world. Okay, here we go. So, you know, pretty incredible campaign, covered everything it had. It had content, it had influencers, it had earned media, it had product, it had sales, and it really had incredible impact. And for the marketers in the room and the brand owners who really want to know the ROI, we're going to talk about that one. But here's what we learned, right? You know, the first thing I'll say is, when somebody talks to me about the mess-free challenge or going a little bold and disruptive, I'll say, find your Nick Kyrgios. Find the guy that's going to do it for you, that's going to do it his way. And one of the best parts of being able to do this during the pandemic at the French Open was, think of the tennis players as influencers, and this is one of the best rules I think I keep hearing about influencers is, you know what, collaborate, don't dictate. We just let them do their thing, and we're like, do you know what, just roll with it. You know your audience, you're in it for a good cause. I mean, the second one is an obvious one, and we keep hearing it, right? Like, doing good is good for business, you know, and for headlines, and for social currency, and we saw it everywhere. I mean, and finally for us, you know, Old El Paso is as big as a global brand as it is. We've never, ever done anything globally, right? We tend to be really focused on our individual regional pockets. But as we saw this turn into a movement, we came together as different global teams around the world to rally and turn this into a movement, as did the players. So, and that resulted in what is arguably our biggest ever, you know, award-winning campaign. We won awards in three continents. This has never happened to us here at General Mills. And so it really showed the power of using your size and scale to be a force for good, and to really be agile and lean in to a moment in culture when you sense it and you run with it, right? And here's for, obviously, you know, this is really for, you can't really treasure what you can't measure. You know, we put ourselves, as the campaign started out, we really had some initial measures of what we thought success would need to look like. And when we looked at what we were hoping to get to, you know, as you can see on all of these various metrics, whether it's impressions, whether it's engagement rate, organic engagement rate, whether it's, you know, PR impressions and pieces of coverage, we smashed our objectives. Numbers? Did we sell? Oh, yeah. I mean, this is our biggest ever innovation. You know, within the first 2 months of launch, we were tracking at 60% ahead of forecast. 6 months in, we were almost double. We were 92% of our forecast. And oh my, and you know, we already have a sizable range and we have a very big market share. Being able to bring in new shoppers is so hard. And it's and driving 70% incrementality of the category. And then the fact is, tortilla pockets was either the number one or the number two selling SKU in all of our European and Australian markets where we launched within the first 3 months of Nielsen. And finally, you know, as we launched it in Australia, we were like, oh my God, it's gonna happen in the French Open. What if we kind of got a bit of coverage and got some donations? We said, wow, what if we could get to 50,000 donations in UK, France, or Spain? But you know what? This went to North America, this went to Asia, this went to LATAM, and we got to 100,000 to a point where, you know, we literally had to stop because we didn't have any other products to donate anymore. So this totally blew our expectations. We loved it so, so, so much, as did Nick. And if you know anything about Nick, and I hope you guys are supporting him tomorrow, I know it's a hard one because he's up against Nadal in the semis. Nick loves basketball more than tennis. So he came back to us with an idea, and he said, what if we could do this? What if we could do a slam dunk mystery challenge and get all the biggest influential people from the NBA and the WNBA involved, And what if we could get to 200,000? And guess what? We so did. We so did. And so, you know, that's just a little story of how, you know, we leaned into our purpose, how we leaned into what innovation could be, and how we turned what was a classic FMCG launch, disrupting the rules, going against FMCG convention, to turn this into a social media challenge that turned into one of the biggest ever charity movements that we were able to do, leaning into our force for good, creating good noise in the world. Thank you very much. It's an honor. And a happy Taco Thursday. Any questions?
I'm the question master. Anyone any more questions, do send them in. We are very close to being done. That was amazing. Thank you. I really want to know how you become an ideas. Like, what did you say your job title was?
Head of Growth Ideas.
Yeah,
creative.
How do you get that? I want that job.
I do too.
So Sam has asked, which of the tennis stars did you have to pay?
I would say most of them, but at far, far lower rates than you would ever imagine. Quite simply because it came directly from Nick. Nick called up his friends. It was really a friends, and it was a tennis friends movement. Like Nick telling Andy reaching out to his stars, his tennis player friends. We asked the players was like, you know what? We'll help you with the donations. You help us get the players. And obviously, because it is branded content and it is hashtag ad or hashtag partner, it was significantly different and differential to what you would ever have to do. I mean, most of these players are some of the biggest names in their countries. They would never do something this one-off, but they really loved the concept and the purpose behind it and the fact that they could all come together and be a force for good.
Amazing. I'd love to know, actually, because obviously Old El Paso is an established brand, and I know at one point you were like, ooh, they were like, no, you can't use Nick Kyrgios. But, like, I'm imagining the budget for this thing was quite big because you've got all the giveaways and all of the promotional materials and then all the effort. Like, how did you manage to get buy-in at, like, the top levels for them to take a punt on something that, you know, they didn't know was going to succeed?
So the first thing to say, the budget was not that big, right?
Okay.
You know, we had a budget against our above the line and below the line that was going on, and this was a kernel of an idea that was born in Canberra, right? It was the Australian team saying, hey, what if we could get Nick Kyrgios, because he's already out there, you know, helping families out during COVID, and then, you know, with him getting on board, with him getting excited, with him not playing tennis, this is something he really was passionate about, and you know, it truly reflects on your choice of brand ambassador or partner who aligns with your values and someone who goes above and beyond.
Yeah. And last question, because I know everyone's dying for Carnival. Did you boost the campaign with paid efforts, for example, TV?
Not linked to the Mess Free Challenge. There was a TV campaign linked to each country at the time of its launch where there was a 2-3 week flight. But this pretty much happened all during the French Open. This was completely unplanned. What we did do was take some of the athlete or tennis star content and put a bit of paid behind it so that there was a bit of an awareness around what the challenge is doing. Because not only were there donations, but for every share of their Mess-Free Challenge, we were able to add donations on top. So that was there was a call to action to enable us to really get to the big number that we wanted to in each country.
Amazing. Thank you. Thank you so much for giving up your time to talk to us today. Can everyone put their hands together for Arjoon? Thank you. Cheers.